Have you heard of E.K. Janaki Ammal? Maybe you haven't, and that's okay. It's never too late to learn. Let me start with something you probably have heard of. Silent Valley, the national park in Kerala, home to some of the rarest flora and fauna in India. And it's actually one of the most biodiverse and undisturbed spots on the planet. This is the part that you probably know about Silent Valley. But did you know that in the 1970s, the government of India actually came pretty close to willfully drowning a large chunk of the national park? The plan was to build a hydroelectric plant, which would provide electricity and jobs to the state of Kerala. To do this, they would need to flood nearly 8.3 square kilometers of the forest with the water from the river Kunti. When this was announced, there was a huge protest by activists, by environmentalists, and by scientists in the country. And the reason was they knew that no amount of jobs, no amount of electricity could justify destroying such a pristine and evergreen forest. Now, if you read or watch the news every day, you'll know that such protests are quite common. Every time there's a huge industrial project announced, there's likely to be some sort of protest happening in some corner of the country. But unfortunately, most of the time, they're not successful. That's because the people who want these projects to happen are really powerful and really rich, and they find a way to make it happen. So the reason that the Save Silent Valley movement made news, or we know it today, is because it was one of the very few successful ones. And a big reason it was successful is because it had some big names that were standing up for it. And one of these names was the botanist E.K. Janaki Ammal. In the 1970s, when the Save Silent Valley movement was going on, Janaki Ammal was already towards the end of her career. She was really famous and well-respected. And I'm not joking when I say she was famous and well-respected. In fact, Janaki Ammal was actually pretty comfortable doing her job in the United Kingdom when she was invited to India back on the request of none other than independent India's first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru. This was a time that India was in actually quite a lot of trouble. Just a few years back, we had lost millions of people to the Great Bengal Famine. And the Prime Minister of the country, Jawaharlal Nehru, knew that we needed some sort of a big revolution in our agriculture, in our food producing capability, to ensure that something as simple as our population had enough to eat. And he correctly recognized that we would need science to be the answer to this. So the only way was to attract India's best scientists back to the country if they were not already here. And Janaki Ammal was one of them. E.K. Janaki Ammal was born in 1897 in the town of Talasheri in Kerala. She was actually one of 19 brothers and sisters. In the time that she was born, it was quite uncommon for girls to be allowed to study to very high levels. And she was one of the few of her sisters who did not get married and chose to pursue academics instead. So she really was bucking the trend when she left to Madras to do her bachelor's and her honors in botany. After she finished her bachelor's and honors in botany, she began teaching at a women's college in Madras. That was when her big break came. She won a scholarship that would allow her to do her higher studies in the US for free. So she set off to the University of Michigan, and by 1931, she had finished her master's and PhD in Michigan. After she finished her PhD, Janaki Ammal actually did return to India. She did the first piece of work that made her pretty well known in the botany circles. What she did was work in the Sugarcane Research Institute in Coimbatore, where she was working on a pretty interesting problem. So India consumes a lot of sugarcane. But what was really curious and what was really not so very good is that the best species of sugarcane that we were used to consuming in the country was a species that was native to India, but that we were importing from Indonesia. So we were spending large amounts of money on something that ideally we should be doing inside our country. So Janaki Ammal, with all the training in botany and plant genetics that she had in the US, She began breeding sugarcane and creating hybrids that could actually grow much better in the climate in India. And thanks to her sugarcane hybrids, India became a lot more independent when it came to producing sugarcane. In 1940, Janaki Ammal left India again. This is because she was invited to work with a really famous plant geneticist called Cyril Darlington. Together with Darlington, Janaki Ammal produced this book called The Chromosomal Atlas of Cultivated Plants. Now, this is a book that is really important to botanists even today, because unlike most books which list plants and their species names, this book listed plants and the number of chromosomes of each of these species for more than 100,000 species. And it's really important to know how many chromosomes a plant has if you are interested in breeding them, if you're interested in understanding how they evolved. So looking at the kind of work, the quality of work that she was doing, Janaki Ammal was actually invited, she was offered another job in the Royal Horticultural Society, also in the United Kingdom. She joined the Royal Society as a cytologist, and she was actually the first salaried woman staff member of the society, which is a big deal because she not only broke barriers for Indian women, but she also broke barriers for women worldwide in this international society for botanists. So what did she do at the Royal Society of Horticulturists? She actually played around with this interesting chemical called colchicin. Now, colchicin was pretty cool because what it did was it doubled the number of chromosomes that a plant had. And what you could do with this kind of power is you could create plants that were bigger and that grew faster than the traditional plants. So one of the results of Janaki Ammal's experiments was a special kind of magnolia plant. It produced big white flowers with purple stamens, and it was so remarkable that eventually the flower was named after Janaki Ammal. It was named Magnolia Cobus Janaki Ammal. So you get the picture. Janaki Ammal was a pretty big deal in the world of botany, and it was really no wonder that Nehru wanted her to come back. And she accepted, of course, because she knew what a critical situation the country was in, and she was ready to do whatever she could to help out. Janaki Ammal came back to India, where she was appointed as the first director of the Central Botanical Laboratory in Lucknow. In this role is where she did possibly the biggest contribution that she could, or any botanist could in India, which was she reorganized the Botanical Survey of India. So the BSI, or the Botanical Survey of India, is basically a study that is done to figure out what are the different species of plants that exist in India and what are their characteristics, what are their chromosome number, and all kinds of information. The problem with the way the BSI was before Janaki Ammal took over was that the whole survey was conducted by British scientists, and all the plants that they found out and they wanted to study, the research had to be done in the United Kingdom. This is something that upset Janaki Ammal a lot, because she thought that how can it be that to study the plants of India, you have to go outside India to do this. She knew that to make any real progress in Indian botany and Indian agriculture, Indian scientists had to be able to do this research inside our own laboratories. So this is something that she was determined to work towards. It was in the senior stages of her career that Janaki Ammal started to become more vocal and started to care very strongly about environmental issues like deforestation and like the hydroelectric project that was coming up in Silent Valley. As part of the Safe Silent Valley project, one of the things she did was to start a chromosomal survey of all the forest trees of Silent Valley, just to show the kind of diversity that is present there and to make a case that this piece of forest land is simply too valuable for us to lose. So this study of hers was one of the many ways that the government of India actually got convinced to cancel the project, and they instead declared the forest as a protected area, as a national park. Unfortunately, Janaki Amal was not there to witness this historic victory because she passed away just a few months ago in 1984. Though she is no more today, the work that she's done and the knowledge that she's given us really will continue to live on forever. In fact, in the Royal Horticultural Society, every spring, a white flower blooms, the Magnolia Cobus Janaki Amal. So in that sense, Janaki Amal will continue to live on. And I hope that you will not forget her story. If you like this episode on Janaki Amal, be sure to check out our previous episodes on other women scientists from India and from the world. And for sure, don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment on our page. Thank you.